Не отключаюсь. Я отключился.
Good morning, dear friends. We are starting our lecture on regulation of respiration. It's second part of a topic which is devoted to respiratory system. First of all, let me say that the aim of regulation of respiration is the same as for cardiovascular system. It's supply the needs of our tissues in oxygen. And the means by which this aim can be achieved, it's changes of frequency and deep of the breathing, because if frequency will be decreased and the deep of breathing will be decreased, in this case our organism can get more oxygen. If functional state of organism needs such quantity of oxygen, more activity, more oxygen our tissues need. Concerning level of regulation, we were talking this year about different level of regulation of activity of functional systems, and you know already that these levels may be more complex or more simply. For example, the simplest level of regulation, it's a level of structural and functional unit of our organism. It's a cellular level, because cell is a functional, a structural unit of human body. More complex level, it's a tissue and the organ level. And you have seen very well how this level play important role in regulation of definite organs, for example, in regulation of heart. More complex level, it's system level, when system regulates itself, for example, as a cardiovascular system, or other systems, excretory system you'll see, for example. And finally, it's a central level of regulation when we have the most complex type of regulation, because this level of regulation means that in this case we have complex types of activity of our organism, which needs coordination of activity of different systems. But respiratory system is special system concerning regulation, because here we have only nervous regulation, and it means that in this case we have only central regulation. Why only central regulation? Because you know already mechanism of inspiration and expiration, external breathing, and you understand that regulation of inhalation and exhalation is realized by contraction of respiratory muscles. And respiratory muscles are skeletal muscles. So these muscles have somatic innervation, and somatic innervation means that we have only regulation by somatic or motor centers, which are located at different level levels of central nervous system. That's why we can say about central regulation in relation to respiratory system. If we have, in this case, central regulation of respiratory system, it means that structural base of such regulation is reflex arc. And reflex arc, as you know, has three links, efferent, central, and efferent links. Efferent link from receptors, you can see here different receptors, for example, receptors, mechanoreceptors of lungs, chemoreceptors of vessels, and proprioceptors of skeletal muscles, which send sensory information to center, and its center, first of all, is located in medulla oblongata, and from medulla oblongata, efferent commands can achieve skeletal muscles and the diaphragm that provide external respiration. Let's consider consequently all these links in regulation of respiratory system. First of all, efferent link. I told you already that efferent link are presented by receptors, which send to nervous centers the sensory information. This information may be about, first of all, content of gases in blood, content or partial pressure, partial tension of oxygen and carbon dioxide. In this case, changes of partial tension of these gases on these changes react chemoreceptors. We differ two groups of chemoreceptors, which are located in vessels, its peripheral chemoreceptors, and directly in medulla oblongata, its central chemoreceptors. Besides, we have mechanoreceptors of the respiratory system, these mechanoreceptors react to expansion of lungs during inhalation and the exhalation. Besides, we have proprioceptors. You can see here mechanoreceptors, and you can see here chemoreceptors of vessels. Finally, we have proprioceptors, which are located in skeletal muscles and react of expansion or react on contraction or relaxation of respiratory muscles. It's intercostal muscles and diaphragm. All these types of information, due to activity of all these types of receptors, play important role in regulation of activity of nervous center, respiratory center. This regulation is realized in response on needs, changes of needs of tissues in oxygen and carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide regulate, of course, but needs, first of all, in oxygen of tissues is a regulatory factor, which regulate activity of these receptors. From these receptors, sensory information goes to center along efferent nervous. You can see here on this picture how changes of partial tension in carbon in vessel causes changes of impulsation along this nervous. You can see here number of impulses per second, and here changes, possible changes of arterial partial pressure for oxygen. And you can see more concentration, and it means more partial tension of oxygen in blood, less or lower number of impulses. And if organism needs more oxygen because has sufficiency quantity of oxygen, in this case impulsation increases. But not only oxygen play important role in regulation of activity and excitability, excitation of chemoreceptors and the sending of sensory information to nervous center. Because we have classic experiments of scientists, named this scientist Frederick. This scientist shown role of carbon dioxide, and this carbon dioxide, this gas, plays very important role to in regulation of activity of chemoreceptors and the nervous center, respiratory center. It's an experiment, these two dogs, which have cross section and blood supply, when head of one dog send connect this body of other dog, and this dog has asphyxia. And in this case, oxygen cannot pass to body of this dog, and the concentration of carbon dioxide becomes very high. And this blood, this very high concentration and partial tension of carbon dioxide, this blood comes to head of other dog, and comes to respiratory center, and it causes stimulation of neurons and stimulation of breathing. And the very small changes of carbon dioxide able to stimulate of breathing more extensively than changes of oxygen. So carbon dioxide plays very important role in regulation of respiration. You can see here chemoreceptors which react on changes of concentration of gases in blood, and it's receptors of carotid body, and the carbon dioxide, the most important gas in stimulation of these bodies, and the sending sensory information and pulsation to nervous center, respiratory center. We know that between peripheral receptors and the central receptors there is differentiation. Carotid, I told you that carotid sinus react more actively on changes of carbon dioxide. Other area where chemoreceptors are located is aorta, NCAM receptors here react more actively on more active on in reaction to oxygen. And this the most important areas where CAM receptors are located, and these CAM receptors play very important role in regulation. Sometimes we talk about humoral regulation, but it isn't humoral regulation, it's humor factors which play important role in regulation, but not realize this regulation directly, of course, because it's efferent link, only efferent link of reflectory arc. These areas, carotid, sinus, and the aorta, it's the same important area as you have seen for cardiovascular system. For respiratory system, of course, these areas play the most important role, because carotid sinus plays important role in blood supply of brain, and the aorta gives us information, or our body, our centers information about blood supply of all our body. It's peripheral important areas, but we have central chemoreceptors, chemoreceptor areas, and you can see here blue color, these areas, rostral, you can see, and the caudal, chemosensitive areas in on the ventral surface of medulla. This area are located near respiratory center, which are located approximately here, and these areas react on changes of pH. But it needs say that concentration of hydrogen ions depends on concentration of carbon dioxide. That's why hypocapnia, when concentration of carbon dioxide becomes lower, hypocapnia we can observe when the this concentration decreases, and this term we use in order to indicate this state. And hypoxemia, I told you already, it's it means lower concentration, lower partial tension of oxygen in blood, and in result of hypoxemia we have hypoxia in tissues, when tissues haven't enough oxygen for biochemical processes. So when we have changes of carbon dioxide, we can observe changes of pH, and these changes will influence on activity of respiratory center. These were central chemoreceptors areas. Mechanoreceptors, of course, plays important role in sending sensory information about expansion of respiratory system, about expansion of lungs, of conducting portion of respiratory system. And the best example of role of mechanoreceptors is the herringbone reflex. Its reflex means that strong stimulation of inhalation and strong expansion of lungs will causes stop of inhalation and stimulation of exhalation. By other words, herring Breyer's reflex is stimulated by pulmonary stretch receptors, which are located, first of all, in interalveoli spaces, not in wall of alveoli, in interalveoli spaces. And more expansion of lungs causes more activation of expiratory neurons. So strong inhalation causes exhalation. The activation of these receptors during inspiration inhibits the respiratory control centers, making further inspiration increasingly difficult. You can see here a similar situation, not real situation, of course, but this reflex is real reflex, and in realization of this reflex, very important role play mechanoreceptors. Concerning receptors, proprioceptors of skeletal muscles, I can say only, I can repeat only the same, that contraction and relaxation of muscles, you know that between extrafusal fibers, skeletal fibers, there are intrafusal or proprioceptors allocated, and these receptors, muscular receptors, react on stretch of these muscles and the contraction of these muscles, and the end result of that, impulsation from these receptors can comes to center, respiratory center, and regulate breathing. These three types of receptors, chemoreceptors, mechanoreceptors of respiratory system, and the proprioceptors of skeletal muscles, play important role in current regulation of respiration. But we have some situations when additional receptors can react on strange stimuli. For example, in lungs in and conducting portion, there are irritant, so-called irritant receptors, which stimulate constriction of the bronchioles in response to some substances which can come in the respiratory system. It may be smoke, or some chemical substances, or small particles in atmospheric air. And in this case, excitation of these receptors causes sniffing, sneezing, and coughing, which are okay due to excitation of receptors, which are located in the receptors in the nose, larynx, and trachea. And the reflexes which arise in this situation we call as defensive respiratory reflexes. Efferent nerves that deliver sensory information in respiratory center, it's efferent fibers of vagus, first of all, and glossopharyngeal nerves, which send the impulsation, the sensory information from vessels and from respiratory system to centers, two respiratory centers. Of course, because proprioceptors participate in this sending of information, somatic nerves play some role in sending of this information, because proprioceptors of skeletal muscles, this information bring afferent fibers of somatic nerves. So it's afferent nerves. Ну я же лекцию читаю. Afferent nerves, which send sensory information to nervous center. Plays functional role of vagus. We can observe in result of experiment this cross section of vagus. You can see here normal briefing in dog, but if we will do cross section of vagus, which send sensory information to respiratory center in medulla oblongata, in this case this sensory information about expansion of respiratory system cannot be delivered in time, and in result of that respiratory center cannot react in time on changes of level of expansion of lungs, and you see that in this case breathing will be changed rarely. Contraction of respiratory muscles occurs, and in this case frequency of breathing becomes slower. So receptors, chemo, mechano, proprioceptors, and efferent pathways, it's vagus, glossopharyngeus nervous, and somatic, efferent fibers of somatic nerves play important role in providing biosensory information of respiratory center. These are structures of efferent link of respiratory reflex arc. Central link of reflex arc, of course, it's centers which are located in brain. And you know already, because we have considered during first months of education of physiology, we considered physiology of central nervous system, and you know already that vital respiratory center is located in medulla oblongata and pons. Why vital? Because if this center cannot functions, in this case respiration is not possible. But besides these two structures of respiratory, of vital respiratory center, we have other centers, other neurons, which are located in hypothalamus and brain cortex at a higher level of central nervous system. Let's consider functions of all these departments of respiratory centers. First of all, it needs to say that changes of breathing and thus definition of different role of different centers, which are located at different levels of brain and central nervous system have shown by scientist Mislavsky due to cross-section at different levels and the observation on changes of briefing. You can see here normal briefing and you can see as well that if cross-section is located between cervical and thoracic segments of spinal cord, we can observe respiration, but only due to contraction of diaphragm, because skeletal muscles, intercostal muscles cannot contract and provide respiration. When this cross-section we have between spinal cord and brain, in this case, of course, connection between respiratory centers and motor neurons, which innervate respiratory muscles, this connection is damaged, and in this case, respiration cannot be. At different levels higher of cross-section, give us briefing, but of course we have different changes of relation between inhalation and exhalation. So in result of that, we can say that in vital respiratory center, which are located in medulla oblongata and pons, we have two groups of neurons. It's dorsal and ventral respiratory groups of neurons, and we call these groups conditionally by center dorsal group, inspiration and the expiration centers. It means that the most part neurons in inspiration center participate in inhalation. And the most group of ventral group, most part of ventral group of neurons, and this center, this department we call as expiratory center, participate or provide of exhalation. So to these groups provide phases or stages or steps of breathing. Inhalation in inspiratory center and exhalation expiratory center. But coordination of activity of these centers and the time of inhalation and exhalation is regulated by centers which are located in pons. We talk about two departments here, apneistic and pneumotaxic centers, and function of these centers, its regulation of prolongation of inspiration and expiration prolongation. That's why, let's come back on to this picture, that's why when between these centers we have cross-section, sensory information from inspiratory center cannot go to pneumotaxic and apneistic center in pons, and the regulation of prolongation becomes, this regulation in time cannot possible in time, and in result of that we have changes in prolongation of inhalation. You can see here again how different cross section can cause changes of briefing. And you can see it's very different changes maybe, which indicate different role of these departments of vital respiratory center. Between these departments is a very complex relations, very complex connections, and you can see here these departments. It's a pneistic center, it's different neurons which are located in medulla oblongata. Of course, you shouldn't know function of all these groups, but you should understand that due to such complex relations between these centers, we have such important property of respiratory vital respiratory center as automaticity. It isn't absolute automaticity as we can see have seen in heart. No, because in order to regulate correctly prolongation of inspiration and expiration, apneistic and pneumotaxic centers need sensory information from receptors. But if this information absence, excitation of neurons of inspiratory and expiratory centers will be, but prolongation of these phases of respiration will not correct. So what we can say about automaticity of respiratory centers? It means spontaneous respiration, continues even after isolation of the brain stem at the inferior body of the pulse. This property is very important as well, because help to continue breathing if connection this over structure of nervous center is not possible. But I repeat again, this respiration, this breathing will not correct and enough in active functional state of organism. Maybe enough in order to maintain respiration in relaxation state, but not at active actions of organism. Thus, we have vital departments of respiratory centers which are located in medulla oblongata and pons, and these centers provide unconscious control of breathing, and it's a simple automatically regulation. But I repeat again, this regulation needs information from peripheral receptors. That's why we can say that automatism or automaticity of respiratory center is not absolute as in heart, and its automatism is relative relative, because in order this realization, this property, centers need information from peripheral receptors, sensory information. It's simple automatic regulation of breathing. We don't think how we should to inspire or expire, because it realizes automatically. But more complex regulation of this system, respiratory system, first of all, is realized, of course, by influences from high located centers in our central nervous system. And that's why we can say about participation in regulation of breathing, hypothalamus and the brain cortex. And each level of regulation, high located level, send a different command to lower located centers, including pons and medulla oblongata, via our structures. For example, if hypothalamus can regulate activity of vital department centers, brain cortex can regulate these centers via hypothalamus, of course. And the higher located center, more complex regulation we can observe. So on this picture you can see you can see receptors which can send information, sensory information, to medulla oblongata and to vital respiratory centers. It's chemoreceptors, which we have just considered. It's mechanoreceptor, chemoreceptors of vessels, mechanoreceptors of lungs and the respiratory system, proprioceptors of skeletal muscles. And it needs say that besides this irritant receptors, which react, which excite and cause defensive respiratory reflexes in some situations, we can observe participation in regulation, in influence, more correct, on respiration of receptors. It's pain receptors, for example, and you can see here examples such influences. And it's maybe temperature receptors as well, of course. And all receptors which react on external factors can influence on our respiration. But in current regulation of respiration, of course, the most important role plays chemoreceptors, mechanoreceptors, and proprioceptors of respiratory system and vessels. What function more complex, what functions centers which participate in more complex regulation of respiration and which are located in at the higher located levels of central nervous system, levels of brain. Concerning hypothalamus, first of all, you can see here scheme of respiratory centers which regulate in respiration, and here it's a regulation of skeletal muscles we can see here. And it needs say that all centers which are located higher provide more complex regulation. If if we have at the level of Battle of Langata, level of hindbrain, where vital center, respiratory center is located, I told you already, we have here unconscious automatic regulation of our breathing. But at the different toxic functional state, it may be psychogenic action, psychogenic states, it may be physical loads, different stresses or emotional state. In this case, we have more complex regulation, and such regulation we name is conditioned regulation, because or conditioned reflexes, because in this case we can observe changes of respiration in response on action of external factors, not internal sensory information, as in case these chemoreceptors, in mechanoreceptors of respiratory system. But it may be reaction on changes of temperature, for example, and in this case we have realization of these changes by participation of hypothalamus, because center which regulate temperature in our body is located in hypothalamus. It may be reaction on pain sensations, we have as well participation subcortical structures in changes of respiration. And finally, it may be such complex conditioned reflexes as in this example, before a start to run, sportsman has changes of breathing, but in this case, before start, we haven't active contraction of skeletal muscles yet, but reaction on this condition, starting and running after start, we have already changes of respiration. And the very demonstrative example of conditioned regulation of respiration, of course, is conscious or voluntary regulation of respiration. We can delay of respiration before diving, for example. It is during speech, during singing, and it's possible due to somatic innervation of respiratory muscles. That's why in example of respiratory system, regulation of respiratory system, we have exclusively example of conscious regulation of visceral system. We cannot change consciously activity of our heart, maybe except Indian yoga, but we can delay our respiration in some situations, and these situations you can see here. That's why respiratory system, it's a very interesting system, and we have some respiratory gymnastics in order to, without drugs, regulate activity and influence on our respiratory system. And it play important role in really in recover of functioning of this system is if we have some changes, some diseases of this system. And correct breathing, it's very important opportunity for us in order to regulate activity of our peripheral, our visceral system without therapy and drugs. In some cases, of course, not in all cases. Okay, it was central link of reflex arc, and now we'll talk about efferent link of reflex arc. Efferent link of reflex arc are presented by motor neurons in spinal cord and efferent fibers which innervate diaphragm and the intercostal muscles. You can see here again central link, it's brain cortex, which influence on hypothalamus. Hypothalamus influence on centers in pons. Pons can regulate activity inspiratory and expiratory centers in medulla oblongata. And these centers in medulla oblongata send efferent command to motor neuron in cervical, to cervical segments of spinal cord. You can see here what cervical segments are included in this efferent link of reflex arc, and to thoracic segments. You can see here what thoracic segments participate in innervation and contraction of intercostal muscles and diaphragm. Efferent neurons in the spinal cord, it's neurons which are located in ventral horns of spinal cord from third to till fifth cervical segments, and thoracic segments from first to sixth segments. And from these neurons, efferent or somatic nerves send efferent command to intercostal muscles and diaphragms. But in this case, we can say only respiratory regulation of respiratory portion of our respiratory system. Because if we talk about regulation of conducting portion, in this case we really have visceral nervous, it's efferent fibers of vagus and sympathetic nervous, which send fibers to smooth muscles of conducting portion of respiratory system. And somatic nerves and motor neurons of spinal segments play important role in regulation of inhalation and exhalation, in biomechanic processes of respiration. In case this regulation by vegetative nervous of conducting portion of respiratory center, we have situation which can play very significant role at some pathological states. For example, vagus can cause strong constriction of bronchioles at such diseases as asthma. And in this case, respiration becomes very difficult. Sympathetic nervous, vice versa, causes relaxation of smooth muscles. And we can observe this situation and stresses, for example, when our tissues need more oxygen at stresses in order to realize more active, more intensive activity, action, running, or over reactions, types of reactions. That's why, in order to stop asthmatic attack, we use in medicine sympathomimetics. It's drugs, this catecholamines, a similar action. You remember, I hope, that sympathetic nervous use such neurotransmitter as norepinephrine. And we use sympathomimetic in order to cause relaxation of smooth muscles in conducting portion of respiratory system. So, efferent neurons are controlled by two major descending pathways from cerebral cortex via hypothalamus. And in this case, we have control voluntary breathing in the different conditions of environment and different emotional states and different types of our activity. And from medulla oblongata, second pathway, which control the involuntary breathing, more simple regulation of the breathing. Some words about changes of breathing in some special conditions of external environment or types of activity. Increased barometric pressure. We feel changes due to increased barometric pressure during diving, for example. Decrease atmospheric pressure we have when we comes in mountain depends on altitude in relation to surface of if we have in this case different changes, but reason of these changes is the same. It's disorder of second stage of respiration. I remind you that it's a gas exchange in lungs. For normal gas exchange in lungs, we should have a definite gradient of pressure of gases. For oxygen and for carbon dioxide. But if we comes in mountain or if we diving, in this case we have changes of barometric pressure or atmospheric air, and this gradient, pressure gradient, is increased or decreased than it needs. I remind you, for oxygen, this gradient may be 60 millimeters of mercury, and for carbon dioxide, 6 millimeters of mercury. But if we have in atmospheric air changes, not 100 and more during diving, for example, more pressure or lower pressure if we come in mountain, in this case we can we have some changes in briefing. For example, decreased pressure causes acute mountain sickness or altitude sickness in untrained person. Why? Because due to decrease of pressure in atmospheric air, saturation blood by oxygen decreases as well. In result of that, we have increased pulmonary ventilation in order to compensate this insufficient quantity of oxygen. But more oxygen will not become in a mountain, and the carbon dioxide will be released more extensively during such intensification of breathing. And the result of that, we have decrease of carbon dioxide partial tension. And the carbon dioxide is very strong stimulator of respiratory center. And in this case, we can observe inhibition of activity of respiratory center and respiration. And as we can see here, for example, in this case, breathing may be such a configuration and such a type, pathological type of breathing, we name as chain Stokes breathing, and can observe this breathing during sleep in mountain. You can see apnea stopping of breathing because concentration of carbon dioxide in this case is lowest, but after such apnea we have stimulation breathing during short time. Altitude disease causes different changes in total functional state of organism, not only in respiratory system, because changes in breathing causes changes by supply oxygen supply our tissues. And you can see here altitude in meters. In Crimea, for example, we have our mountain has have altitude till 1,500 meters. If you hire Roman Kosh, our the highest mountain, and this altitude is very useful for organism because on this altitude we have training of all systems of our organism. Such soft hypoxia very useful for adaptation and for stimulation of reserve sources of our organism, of functional reserves of our organism. But if we have mountain this higher altitude, we can stimulation of heart activity, changes in sensations of our head. We have changes in vision. Then higher it's a disorder of sleeping. It's a such state, psychical state is aphoria, apathy. It's disorder of coordination of motor activity, higher it's a disorder of refractory activity, then edema of lungs, edema of brain, and higher here it's that area where hallucinations may be, and deaf. And here you can see different mountain in different places of war. The highest altitude has Everest, and it's Mont Blanc, Elbrus, for example, McKinley, Hoon, Himalchuli, Picanetto, etc. If we have increased pressure during diving and the action of this increased pressure, we can observe the compression sickness or caisson disease. Why? Because in this case, not only oxygen diffuse through hematoalveoli barrier, but nitrogen, inert gas as well, and the nitrogen and the excess of oxygen causes during diving, first of all, excess of oxygen can cause euphoria and changes psychical and other functional systems of organism. But at lifting, we can observe such event as gas bubbles. You can see here in different in vessels, first of all, and in tissues as well, because nitrogen cannot be realized in time during fast lifting, because it's inert gas, and this gas through hematoalveoli barrier cannot pass quickly, and such bubbles stop blood supply, and result of that tissue ischemia develops, and in this case we have very strong damage of blood supply of some organs, and it causes to death or to very very strong states, which can be very, which can influence very negatively on functions. During physical exercises, you can see how changes breathing in untrained males and sportsmen, and regulation of respiration in this case can be expressed in a higher frequency and increase of pulmonary ventilation, which can achieve, you can see, 110 liters if quiet respiration, it only 6 or 8 liters, but during physical loads, hard physical loads, you can see in 10 times, approximately in 10 times, this volume can be increased. And at first stages, we can observe conditioned reflex regulation of breathing. It's activation of sympathetic system, and it's a physical stress for our body, for our organism. But after that, more important plays in pulsation from muscles, which stimulate respiratory center. And some pathological types of respiration, one type, chain stocks breathing, I have shown you already, we can observe such type during intoxication, for example, not only during sleep in mountain, intoxication. It's a briefing of BOTS when we have damage of brain and increase of pressure in brain. The briefing Kusmauls, the briefing at metabolic acidosis, for example, gasping when newborn burn in not in time, etc. You can see different types of such pathological state. And it needs to say that this age, we have of course changes in functioning of respiratory system, and this age vital capacity decreases, dead space increases, so volume of air which participate in gas exchange decreases as well. Decreases not only functional parameters due to these changes, but structure of respiratory system as well. For example, elasticity of lung tissue decreases as well, and not only because it, and quantity of capillaries in alveoli wall decreases as well. So functional opportunity of this system, respiratory system, decrease this age. Okay, that may be all for today. And if you have some question to me, you can say, you can ask me now, or you can ask your teacher during practical lesson. I wish you good luck in preparation of this material. I hope I was useful for you. If you have any questions, good luck and goodbye, dear friends.